conversation with somebody and it says, how you doing, brother, or how you doing, sister? And they say, well, I'm just barely getting by. Anybody had that conversation? I know I have. And I have been there. But you know, God never intended on us to live like that. The Holy Spirit that engulfed Peter on the day of Pentecost, when he preached the message and 5,000 people were saved, is the same Holy Spirit that you and I have living within us each and every day. And that's what this song talks about. And listen to the words as I say, as I sing, say I want. Today, it all begins. I'm singing my life for the very first time through a different lens. Yesterday, I didn't understand. Driving 35 with the rocket inside, didn't know what I had. While I've been waiting to live, my life's been waiting on me. I'm gonna run. No, I'm gonna fly. I'm gonna know what it means to live, and I'll just be alive. The world's gonna hear, 'cause I'm gonna shout, and I will be dancing with circumstances, drown the music out. Say I won't. Not enough is what I've been told, but it must be a lie, 'cause the spirit inside says I'm so much more. So let them say what they want. Oh, I dare them to try. I'm gonna run. No, I'm gonna fly. I'm gonna know what it means to live, and not just be alive. The world's gonna hear, 'cause I'm gonna shout, and I will be dancing with circumstances, drown the music out. Say I won't. Say I won't.
Bible, if you would, and turn to Matthew chapter 6. That's where we've been. That's where we'll be for a little bit. Matthew chapter 6. And while you're finding that, I was looking at a story the other day about a few years ago in Louisiana, a little city in Louisiana, a small little town. And a nice town. It was, it had been there established for 30 so years. And it was going good. I mean, everything looked pretty good. It looked like a typical town, you know. But what they found was, over a short period of time, in the last little few years here, and then more progressively in the last years, that it was all of a sudden people were coming down with cancer. There was a continued amount of people coming down with cancer and respiratory problems and abnormal cysts and things like that. It was just a lot of medical issues that were going on with this town that no one really realized. They started tracing it back a little bit, and they looked and they said, you know, it wasn't like that for a while, but it was lately it's been like that for the last few years. And what they found was this: when they did their research and started seeing some things around them, they found that the town, over 30-something years ago, in the later 80s, they found that this town had been built upon a toxic landfill. And so someone had just, all the carcinogens and all the different things they put in these barrels and just different chemicals they put in these things that were toxic, just buried them in the ground and covered it up with good dirt and started building houses and a little town and on top of this toxic landfill, which caused eventually the barrels to burst and the things to create, and just sort of just seeping up into the ground and surfacing. And as a result, many people started getting sick, and many people started having more issues of cancer and all the different diseases. And so it was just a very tragic thing to see, because here's some people who thought they built their homes, they built their lives, their families upon solid foundation issues, only to find out that through the creeping dirt, the toxic waste was coming up and being a part of their life and destroying their homes and destroying their lives. The people before them thought it was too costly to deal with the EPA and all the different things like that to take care of the issues. To take care of all that, to get it out would be very difficult, very time-consuming, very expensive. So what they thought was, we just cover it up. And if we cover it up, everything will be okay. 30 years later, it's not okay. It takes its toll. I thought about that, and I thought what Jesus says here in this passage we're going to look at today, there's a lot of people that do just that in their lives. They get hurt. They get offended. Somebody says something, does something to them. They get mad. They get angry. They get bitter. Instead of dealing with the issue the way God would have us deal with it, through forgiveness, as believers, we just put good dirt on it, cover it up, build our little homes, build our families, and all of a sudden, maybe months, maybe years later, the toxicity of the unforgiveness creeps into our homes and our lives and our families. And we wake up one day and go, what in the world is going on? Only to dig out the whole issue and to stop and realize we've just covered up a lot of issues that should have been dealt with. Instead of cleaning them up, we've covered them up. I want to ask you this morning, you ever been hurt? You say, yeah. But have you ever been hurt to the point where you don't deal with it? You sort of just say, it's easier, it's less costly if I just cover it up and go my way. I'm not going to bother anybody with it. I'm just mad. I'm just going to cover it down. I'm just going to push it down. The only problem is, it may be weeks, it may be months, it may be years. It starts coming up, destroying a lot of areas of your life, and you don't realize it because you've tried to cover it up and just deal with it the way you think is best. We'll talk today about the priority of forgiving. Last week we talked about the priority of forgiveness, what that means. But today I want to talk more specifically, the last part of this verse that Jesus gives, about how to forgive and why it's important, the priority of forgiving other people. So, again, I warned you last week, if you knew this was coming, so there's probably a lot of people that's not here today because I told them we're going to deal with this. But all joking aside, it is a very important issue. Matthew chapter 6, verse 9, look what Jesus says. He's teaching his disciples how to pray, and he makes a statement. Our Father in heaven, he says, guys, here's how you pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. As Jesus teaches us this passage, he teaches disciples, he's helping us understand that it's a very important to have a priority prayer life with the Father. And he says this, when you pray this way, our Father. It's a relationship now. In Christ, it's a relationship. You have a relationship with the Father. So you can say, our Father in heaven. Holy, you're holy and set apart. But you're my Father. Hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will. That's what I want more than anything, is your will to be done. And Lord, I'm dependent upon you. So I'm going to ask you, give me this day my daily bread. Give me my provisions today. And then he says, lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from the evil one, for yours is the kingdom, power, and glory forever. So he puts those together, and then you stop in the middle, and you go, that's this little passage. He says, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Wow. Why is that so important? The word forgive, we looked at last week, the word forgive means to pardon, to cancel a debt. You get that, right? This morning, I went to McDonald's, and I went to McDonald's. I grabbed the breakfast of champions. It's a McGriddle, sausage McGriddle, and a large orange juice. That's my breakfast. And so I had that breakfast, and I said, look at Patrick. Brother Patrick, I said, hey, you need anything? He said, well, give me a Dr. Pepper. And I said, okay, I'll get you Dr. Pepper. So I go in there. I get in line. I wait, and I tell them, hey, I want what I want. I wait, get in line, go through, and I get to the door, and I got my card, and I said, here. And she goes, oh, it's already paid for. I said, what? She said, it's paid for. She said, look at me. She goes, you owe nothing. I mean, I guess I looked at the start a little bit. You owe nothing. I said, oh, well, thank you. She don't thank me. I was sure she didn't pay it. Somebody paid. And by the way, if you paid for my, thank you. Appreciate that. Now, let me ask you, what if I'd have went back to Brother Patrick, and I didn't do this, by the way. What if I'd have went back to Brother Patrick and said, oh, by the way, you owe me for that Dr. Pepper. He said, that wouldn't be right. Why wouldn't it? Well, you didn't pay for it, somebody paid for it. You didn't pay for it. I said, right. But if I looked at him and said, you owe me, buddy, let's go. Hey, $2. He'd have said, okay, and he'd paid it. But I'd have been a dog for asking, wouldn't I? Because I mean, somebody paid for it for me. Somebody paid for him too. Forgiveness means to pardon. It means to set free, to cancel a debt. Take your Bible, if you would, and look over at Matthew. Don't you see this passage? Matthew chapter 18, verse 21. We talk about it from time to time. Very, very powerful passage. Because I love, one of the things I'm going to do when I get to heaven, I'm going to get Peter aside and go, dude, you ask all the questions I would have asked. The Bible says in verse 21, then Peter came up to him, Jesus, and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Peter goes, up to 7 times? And I'm the same way. I looked and I said, maybe 10? What? Just, in other words, Peter's asking the question, how long do I got to put up with them before I can smoke them, ignore them, get back at them, get even? Right? I'm asking that question. I would ask the same question. The ultimate, I mean, God is there. And you're going to ask him, he's asking a question. And Jesus said unto him, I did not say up to 7 times, but up to 70 times 7. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is, and by the way, he's not giving a magic number there. But at the same time, I would say this, if you have been forgiving someone for 490 times, whatever, you probably eventually go, I'm over this. If you forgive them. That's what he says. Peter's going, if I forgive them for something, Jesus said, no, keep forgiving. And when he had begun to, he says, therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. When he had begun to settle accounts, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. Now, we talked before, that's millions of dollars in those days. Millions. There's no way he had ever been able to pay that back. So again, owed him 10,000 talents. But as he was not able to pay, true statement, his master commanded that he be sold with his wife and children and all that he had, and that payment be made. The servant therefore fell down before him, saying, Master, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. That statement's not a true statement. He couldn't pay that back. Verse 27, then the master of that servant was moved with what? Compassion. The Bible says, moved with compassion, released him and forgave him the debt. But that servant, verse 28, that servant went out and found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, literally maybe a day's wage. So the one guy's been forgiven millions of dollars. This guy, maybe just a little bit, not much, that owes the guy who's just forgiven all this debt. The Bible says this, he laid hands on him, the guy who's forgiven all this debt, laid hands on this other guy, took him by the throat, saying, pay me what you owe. Now, there's a replay. So his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you all. The same thing he asked the king. But he would not, but went and threw him into prison till he should pay the debt. Let me get this straight. You've been forgiven millions, and this guy owes you pocket change, and you put him in jail? Can you understand why the king's going to be a little upset with that? This is this. Verse 31. I love verse 31. So when his fellow servants saw what he had done, by the way, people are always watching. You understand that, right?
Yeah.
Just so you know. His fellow servants saw what he had done. They were grieved and came and told their master, the king, all that had been done. Then his master, after he had called him, said to him, again, he brings him back in and he's irate. He says, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you begged me. Then the great statement Jesus gives here. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, just as I had pity on you? Boy, if we ever get that down, that'll change our life. We've been forgiven so much. That's the point, isn't it? We've been forgiven so much. And then he pulls him aside and says, shouldn't you have pity like I had pity? The master was angry, delivered him to the torturers that he should pay all that was due to him. And then he says the statement, so my heavenly Father will do to you, also do to you, if each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespasses. Forgiveness, pardon, pay the debt. Owed a lot, but didn't want to forgive a little. How in the world can we not forgive when we've been forgiven so much? I go back to when I had the question, you were hurt, you've gone through a lot. But can you understand for a moment that your sin and mine put the very Son of God on the cross?
Right. Amen, brother.
You understand, your sin and mine put God's Son on a cross. Now let's start putting, you want to compare things, you want to start getting real, let's start looking at the devastation of that compared to how you were hurt. You just don't know what I've gone through. No, I don't, but I do know this, that what Jesus went through on the cross for you and for me is amazing. And I would say, be willing to say, I don't know, ask God when you get there, but I'd be willing to say it's far more devastating what Jesus went through than what you and I have gone through in this life. But we don't compare. We just look at it and say, Lord, in light of the fact of what you've done for me, I'm going to forgive. Peter and John go up to the temple. And they heal this guy comes up to him and say, alms for the poor, alms for the poor. And Peter looks at him and said, silver and gold have I none. But what I give to you, I give you the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Get up and walk. And then the Bible tells us he gets up and he starts jumping around, right? And I love the part about that verse because the Bible says he grabs hold of Peter. And as they go into Solomon's portico or porch there, they go in there and he's got Peter locked in. And and Peter's walking with him. You imagine that, right? He's excited. He hasn't been able to walk. He's been begging for a living. And he goes in and the people are like, whoa. What's up with Lucas, man? Here he is over here. It's not really his name, but here he is. He's walking around now. Isn't he the guy who used to stand outside and just be outside on the ground and beg? Yeah. What happened? Jesus. Jesus. And Peter lays it out, doesn't he? This Jesus, watch, who you crucified, by the way, who, by the way, you chose Barabbas over him. Remember that? Not too long ago. This Jesus, he's the one that did this. Listen to what Peter says. He reminds him of that. And then he says this in chapter 3, verse 19. Repent, therefore, and be converted. Why? That your sins may be blotted out. That your sins may be wiped away. That your sins may be, the little word is, wiped away, canceled, and erased. Repent. Be converted. Who's he telling that to? He's telling it to the very ones that put Jesus on the cross. And he says, you can be forgiven. You can have your sins wiped clean. Therefore, he says, repent, therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, so that times of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord. I want to ask you a question. How awesome is it that our sins are forgiven? I knew that was coming. I put in my notes, question mark, because I knew that was going to be the response. How awesome is it that you and I, if you know Jesus, have your sins wiped clean by the blood of Jesus? That's still sick. That's sad. Are you kidding me? Can we not? I know we're Baptists and we don't get excited because people think we're charismatic. But the truth is, we got to get excited about us. I'm telling you, he's forgiven our sins. And you and I, destiny for hell, because Jesus Christ died in your place on the cross for your sins and mine, your sins have been forgiven in Jesus. If we can't get excited about that, what can we get excited about? Oh, yeah, basketball and baseball and football. I got to get that. I'm telling you, I'm the same way. I get reserved sometimes. But when I read this, I look and I go, how awesome is that? It's not that he just looks and says, well, I'll let you go for a little bit. No. He wipes them clean. It's set free. When you're away from God, separated from him, Jesus came and paid for your penalty of sin. No longer is the penalty over you. Right? The penalty of death, hell, and the grave. Listen, not there anymore because of Jesus. But here's the thing. We still sin, don't we? Yeah. And we said last week, I'm not going to touch this very much, but we said last week that we have been forgiven for the penalty of sin. No, God doesn't hold that against us anymore. We'll see that in a moment. But the truth is, we all sin, don't we? We still sin. The Bible says if you say you have no sin, you're a liar. So anybody says, well, I don't sin anymore, liar, liar, pants on fire. You know what I'm saying? That's just the way that works. But the truth is this, as we are becoming the family of God now, God deals with my sin, but watch this, he deals with my sin not as a judge, he deals with it as a father. And we could go to Hebrews and talk about that too, of how he disciplines and he chastises as we sin. But the truth is this, we don't sin. Listen, I don't go to him. Jesus is saying, I don't go to him to say, save me every day. Save me all over again every day. I don't do that. I go to him and say, God, I sin. And this relationship is strained because of me. And Lord, I come back to you. Forgive me. I said the wrong thing. I did the wrong thing. I acted the wrong way. I did this wrong. God, forgive me for that. Again, it's no different than when in your family, you know, everybody's, you're in the family, you got your son, your daughter there, and they rebel a little bit. And then, you're sitting around the table at dinner, and it's a strained time because there's tension. But then when that repentance comes, when that restoration comes, then it's like a cloud just lifts off, doesn't it? Yeah. And that relationship is restored. Not that you kicked them out, not that they ever ceased to be your children. You're still in the family. Yeah. It's just a strained relationship. At the time, the relationship is maintained. And after judgment again, now we see how the Lord has dealt with our sin through Christ, and now we are forgiven. But notice the second part of this verse. Here's what I wanted to touch on a little bit here today. The second part of this verse, Jesus says this, forgive us our debts, notice, as we forgive our debtors. Now, there's a principle here I want you to remember, and that's this. The forgiven life, you and me in Christ, is to be a forgiving life. The forgiven life is to be a forgiving life. If you've been forgiven of your sins, then you, I, we need to be a forgiving person. Yeah. It is hypocritical for us to be forgiven so much and to harbor anything of unforgiveness against anybody for anything. Again, you ever been hurt? Again, here's the hurt I'm talking about. I'm talking about a hurt that doesn't go away. A hurt, as we said, that when I say that person's face comes to your mind. The hurt is replayed in your mind. And your mind just rolls it over and hits the rewind button instead of the delete button. You know what I'm saying? You just can't sometimes find the delete button because it just rolls around. You try to forget. You put it out of your mind. You're creeping on Facebook, and you see them, and it makes you mad. They post something, here you go again. You run across them. It blows your mind up. The pain, the hurt, the anger. See, it's sort of like covering up a toxic landfill. And until we as Christians learn to forgive, it will always be that way. It will always be toxic. Unforgiveness is toxic because we're not made that way. We've been forgiven so much. And this great God who loves us lives in us. I'd say this. If we don't forgive, if you're in an area of your life you don't forgive, if we don't forgive, it's because we choose not to forgive. It's not because you can't. Oh, you just don't know. No, I don't know, but I do know this. Forgiveness is a choice. Remember some things about forgiveness we're going to look at. Number one, forgiveness is not a feeling. Forgiveness is a choice. Here's where a lot of people get mixed up, and they think, well, you know, I don't feel like it, so I'm not going to. Forgiveness is a choice. It's a commitment. It's a promise. It's something you choose to do. Forgiveness, again, as it comes from God, comes to us from God's heart based on the promise of God's word. See, when I was younger, and I'm about 9 years old, and I gave my life to Christ. I'm just thinking, I'm a sinner. I know that. Forgive me my sins. I went through the whole, I gave him everything I could. I repented everything I could. I mean, I just was like, God, I want to be forgiven. I love you. And I just desired him. You know, didn't want sin in my life. I went through that. But the problem was, as I grew up, I would get in the feeling roller coaster. By that, I mean this. You know, if I did good, then I would go, I'm saved today. And if I did bad, then I would go, oops, I may be lost. I don't know. Am I still saved? I don't know if I'm saved or not. Maybe I am. Hopefully, I hope so. Did I do too much? Did I do too little? What did I do? And before long, it just became this roller coaster. Yeah. Right? Wow. Saved today, lost tomorrow. Saved today, lost tomorrow. Saved today. It just depends on how I feel. Yeah. But then I got into the Bible and found this verse. It's my life. If you have to say, Ron, you have a life's verse, I do. It's John 5:24. And it says this, I memorized this way. Verily, verily, Jesus said, I say unto you, he that hears my word and believes on him that has sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. Amen. Now, here's what happened. As a kid, I looked at that and I got older. I was actually older when it happened. I looked at it and I went, well, that's what Jesus said. And that's what he says. I believe. I trusted him. He says, no condemnation. He says, already passed from death unto life. So if he says that and he's the final judge, logically to me, I was like, I'm good. Based on not Ron's feelings, not what Ron does, not what he doesn't do, but based on God and his word. And I got confidence. And that forgiveness became a reality in my life because I just looked and listen, the enemy or my thoughts or whatever came back and just said, you know, you messed up today. You're probably lost. I go, oh, stop. John 5:24. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that hears my word. And I just quote it back. And before long, watch this, my feelings lined up with my faith. And my feelings lined up with the word of God. See, forgiveness is not a feeling. Why in the world would God do the deepest work in you in the most shallowest part of you? Listen, our feelings are crazy. Yeah. Our feelings just all over the place, and God's like, I'm not going to do my greatest work in those. Let me go deeper. And it's based on his words, based on his promise. Our joy, our confidence, and experience of the forgiveness of God is based on our willingness to take him at his word. That's when you get confidence. That's why the enemy is so animate about keeping us from the book. Because he knows once you read that and you go, are you kidding me? I've been dealing with that all this time. Look what he said. Are you kidding? No, just go there and just go, man, that's the way. And before long, you're living by the word of God instead of by the feelings. And by the way, when you get counsel from other people, usually they're going to tap into your feelings. I'll tell you what, I wouldn't let them do that to me. I'd talk to them. I wouldn't do this. I. Just forget that, as Job should have done, and just go to God and let God deal with him. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 30, listen to what it says again. We talked about this. And do not grieve or bring sorrow to the Holy Spirit of God, by whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. And I like that word sealed. Can we talk about that too, about how you're secure in Christ? But anyway, he says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tenderhearted. Watch this. Here it is. Forgiving one another. Watch this. What? Even. What's the next word? As. Don't miss that word. Even as God in Christ forgave you. God's forgiveness of us is an example of how we are to forgive others. Watch this. God's not up here saying, well, I'm going to forgive this way. You guys just work on it yourself. No, that's why he comes in to dwell our life. That's why he lives in us. The key is getting Ron out of the way and letting the Holy Spirit of God live through me. Yeah. In every area, not just forgiveness. In the genuine expression of forgiveness, what we're saying is this. We're saying, you hurt me, but I'm going to treat you like I was treated. You've made me upset. You've sinned against me. But because of who I am in Christ and because of who he is in me, I'm in turn going to treat you like I was treated. As we said before in witnessing, Dr. Doster, it's just one beggar showing another beggar where to find food. That's what we do when we witness. Hey, let me tell you, I found the bread of life. You want to tell? Let me tell you about it. That's just great. That's the wonder of sharing your faith. But it's also, again, in forgiveness. I've been forgiven so much. I know, but I'm going to forgive you that way. And I'm going to treat you the way God has treated me. Aren't you thankful that we don't that we don't get treated by God the way we treat other people? Aren't you glad? I'm just so thankful that I don't get to go around and just say, this is wonderful to stop and go, God, you treated me this way, and so therefore I choose to make a difference in this person's life. How does God forgive? He says, we are to forgive as God in Christ forgave us. And again, before you say, I can't do it, remember this. I'll tell you, the only reason you can't do it is because God doesn't live in you and you're lost. But if he lives in you, you can forgive. God, listen, God is not going to ask us to do something he's not equipped us to do. Oh, I'll just tell you what. No, stop. You can tell me all you want to, but the bottom line is this. If Christ lives in you, you can forgive. If you're not forgiving, it's because you choose not to. Hebrews chapter 8. Let me give you some verses. This will help you. Hebrews chapter 8 and verse 12. The Bible says, for I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, God says, and their sins and their lawless deeds. Listen to this. I will remember no more. Huh. What do you mean? God looks at our sins. He's not going to remember them anymore? You say, well, that's God, and he can do that. Okay. Isaiah 43, verse 25. I am he who blots out your transgression. You know what the word blot means? The word blot means annihilate. It means to wipe out. In other words, there's nothing left. You annihilate something, it's over. That's the Hebrew word. Blots out your transgression for my own sake, and I will not remember. That word remember in the Hebrew means to recognize or to acknowledge. God says, I'm not going to acknowledge this against you. I'm not going to recognize this against you. Hebrews 10, verse 15. But the Holy Spirit also witnesses to us, for after he has said before, this is the covenant that I will make with them, and after those days, says the Lord, I will put my laws in their hearts and their minds, and I will write them. He says, then he adds, their sins and their lawless deeds I will remember no more. Again, the word, I'm not going to recall those to my mind. I'm not going to bring those up. Stop. Aren't you thankful that God looks at us that way? How can he do that? Listen, in Christ. Because of Jesus. It's all because of Jesus. 1 John 1, 9, if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. All unrighteousness. You need some more verses? I thought you did. Jeremiah 31, verse 34. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they all shall know me. From the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity. That word iniquity means guilt. guilt because of sin. I forgive their iniquity and their sins I will remember no more. Psalm 103, verse 12, as far as the east is from the west, so far as he removed our transgressions from us. Isaiah 1, verse 18, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins be like scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Understand, this is God talking about your sins, about our sins. Micah 7:19, he will again have compassion on us and will subdue our iniquities. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. You say, Ron, how can an omniscient, all-knowing God forget our sins? Listen, God doesn't have amnesia. He's sovereign. He's holy. He's righteous. God doesn't look and go, I just can't remember that. That's not what he's talking about. God has chosen not to hold our sins against us, not to allow them to be on our account, because his wrath upon sin has been appeased, it's been satisfied because of the blood of his son, Jesus.
Amen.
You understand, it's a propitiation, doctor, to stop and look and go, here's the wrath of God going to fall on all those who are lost in their sin. But because of Christ, the wrath has been appeased. It's been satisfied because Jesus took our penalty. Jesus took our sin. He became sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God in him. That's the great picture of the cross. That's the awesome thing that God has done for you and for me. That's why he can look at us and say, that's not on their account anymore. That's been put on my son. And he's paid for their sin. To forgive our sins, as some of our different brothers would say, to forgive our sins and then hold them against us again, God's never going to do that. Well, I can be saved today and lost tomorrow. Not with our God, you can't. Because when he forgave you, you weren't even here. When he forgave you, he forgave all your sins, past, present, and future. And there's no way in the world he's going to hold those against us. But careful. Careful. That's how he wants us to forgive. See, now that's where the rubber hits the road, doesn't it? Now that's when we start drawing lines and going, well, you know, that's God. He can do that, but me, hey, I'm a human. We throw the human card out there. But the problem is we still have the Spirit of God living in us. And forgiveness, again, is a choice. It's a commitment. You say, well, Ron, can you make a promise and a commitment to forgive and not feel like it? Well, sure you can. Absolutely you can. No question at all. I mean, for example, for Dr. Doster, he looks at me and he says, hey, Brother Ron, tomorrow we're going to move some things, and I got some big boxes, books. I've got some things I need moved and help moving. I've got a big bed. I've got some furniture. It's going to be tough. It's going to be hard. Can you help me move? I'm like, yeah. I don't feel like moving boxes and furniture. I don't feel like moving beds and stuff like that. I mean, I just really don't feel like it. I'd rather not do that. I'm not going to tell him that because I love him. And I want to help him. So I look at him and I say, well, what time? And he says, well, tomorrow by 4. I'm like, yeah, I'll be there. So that night I'm like, Jeanette, oh, I got to go move boxes. I don't feel like it. Next day I get up, 4 o'clock. I show up, ready to go. Watch this. I still don't feel like it. But I do it because I love him. I do it because I've chosen to help him. I do it because he needs help and I want to be there for him. I do it because I've committed to do it. And I get done, I probably still didn't feel like it. But I did it because I chose to do it and I promised to do it. I committed to do it. It's the same thing with forgiveness. I just don't feel. I mean, if I don't feel like doing it, I shouldn't do it. Where's that at? That's not anywhere in the Bible. We've got to stop and say, you know what? I commit and make my choice to choose. Well, I would, but I'm not feeling it. If I'm not feeling it, it'd be wrong to forgive. That's nowhere in here either. That's a cop-out. That's a plea, and it's a lie to hell. That is not a standard of forgiveness? Your feelings. Again, your feelings are up and down. They change all the time. Forgiveness is a choice. Forgiveness is a commitment. I choose to forgive you. I choose not to bring it up to you again. Do you hear me? Do you hear that part? That's where we get in trouble, isn't it? I'll forgive them, but I'll sure let everybody know they're a dirty dog. That's not forgiveness. No. The Bible says that God does not hold that to our account anymore. God does not bring that to mind anymore. And He's sovereign. You and I, if we're going to forgive as God in Christ forgave us, and I have to choose to forgive you, I choose not to bring it up again. And by the grace of God and the power of God, I choose not to dwell on it in my mind. I did not say it would not come back, and it'd be, there it is. But you know as well as I do, a lot of that stuff we like to dwell on, and a lot of that stuff we like to play with, and a lot of that stuff we like to just sort of nurture it like it's a little pet. Oh, it's me. Look with me. Somebody's done this to me. I get that. And I'm not being unsympathetic to that. But what I'm saying is this, is if all we do is pet that and feed that and go that way, then we'll never get peace in our life. And then I choose to treat you as forgiven. Well, I've forgiven them. Let me ask you a question. Do you treat them like they're forgiven? You just don't know. I'm not saying I do know. I'm just showing you what forgiveness means when Jesus talks about it. You say, how do you do that, Ron? How do you do that? Like what Peter was told by Jesus. Matthew 18:34, here's what it says. And the master was angry and delivered him to the torturers until he should pay all that was due him. So my heavenly Father will also do to you if each of you, here's the key, watch this, from his what? You see that? Can you see it? What does it say? Not up there. Next. It's from his heart. From his heart. If each of you from his heart does not forgive his brother his trespass. What's Jesus saying? He's saying our forgiveness must be sincere from our heart. I choose to forgive. You say, but I'm not feeling that part, Ron. I'm not feeling that heart part. Right? Then I got to step back and get a perspective. Because out of obedience to God, because he's commanded me to forgive, I'm sincerely seeking to forgive you. My heart's desire must first be a desire to please God. Amen? Amen. When we get this down, it'll deliver us. Listen, life is not about you. It's not about me. And listen, it's not about my hurt, and it's not about what somebody's done to me. It's about how I'm pleasing my Father, how I'm dealing with this in my life. And my heart's desire from my heart needs to be genuine because of my obedience to God and my love for Him. The problem is we think about more about our hatred to someone else and not our love toward God. And that gets us off the focus, doesn't it? Out of a sense of gratitude to God because of the astronomical debt He has paid for me and He's forgiven me, and now I can, with a sincere heart, look at you and go, you know what? Would to God they show everything I did on screen. I sure don't want that at all. And God, I'm going to forgive them, even though they've hurt, even though it does hurt. Because in seeking to please God, that's where you and I can forgive others. And that's where the sincerity of heart comes. I make a choice with my mind. I make a choice with my heart. Because I look and I say, God, it's about you anyway. God, forgive me for being bitter. Forgive me for harboring resentment. Forgive me for that, because you've forgiven me for so much. God, I turn. This person, it's hurtful. This person, it's bad. But you know what? Nothing in comparison. I choose to forgive them. And from the heart, Lord, I want to forgive them because I love you. Each from his own heart. Now again, you're listening this morning. And you're saying, well, I know. But... You're a believer and you're still justifying it by saying, but why do I have to forgive? Why do I have to forgive? Let me give you this real quick. Can I tell you why? And here's a biggie for me. I'm pretty simple. You know me. If you've been around me much, you know me. I'm pretty simple. This is as deep as it gets with me. The reason we are to forgive is because God said so. If you don't need any, you don't need any other reason. Listen, God said, this is how I want my children to act. This is how I want my children to live. This is what I want my fellows, my girls. This is what I want them to do. My sons, my daughters, I want them to act like me when they walk in that world. And so we're commanded to do that. And read, if you have time later, read Matthew 18 and all that. Jesus says, I did not say up to you 7 times, but up to 70 times 7. Just keep on forgiving. Why? Because that's what God does. That's a God mentality. It's a God's heart. Number two, forgiveness is a mark of salvation. It's a mark of salvation. The fact that we can choose to forgive other people and to do that from our heart shows fruit of our salvation. Now, again, we do sin, don't we? And we get back and we go, oh, God, forgive me. And we go back and forth and back and forth with that sometimes. But the reality is this, it's a true mark of salvation that we forgive because we've been forgiven. Number three, forgiveness is an example of Jesus. It's just an example. You need to see Jesus. I heard someone say this, you are no more like Jesus than when you forgive. And you're no more like the devil when you seek to not forgive. Number four, forgiveness brings peace of mind and contentment. You ever seen somebody content that's bitter? You ever seen a happy, bitter person? Doesn't even sound right, does it? She's happily bitter. No. Nope, just bitter. No happiness, no contentment, no peace, no joy, just bitter. See, again, God knows that. Forgiveness, you say, well, they're going to get off scot-free. Are you kidding me? The wages of sin is always death. Our God takes care of all of that. That's not your job and my job to be the ultimate judge. God knows that forgiveness for you and for me is forgiveness for you and me. Because he knows the contentment and the peace it brings to be able to be going, you know what? Watch this. When you and I are unforgiving, everything we look at filters through those people. Everything. You can't be happy about anything. Maybe a few things, not much. Because it all goes back to, well, I've been hurt, 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 I've been hurt. Set free. Listen, that's what forgiveness does. It sets you free. It sets you free. Again, how can I pray, oh God, forgive me when I choose not to forgive someone? And the fifth thing, again, forgiving delivers us from God's discipline. Hebrews 12, you can read that, 1 Corinthians 11. I'm going to read this verse to you, and then I'm going to wind this down. Matthew chapter 5, verse 23, Jesus said, therefore, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. Watch this. Is it on the screen? First, be reconciled to your brother. First, get right with him. Then, come and offer your gift to God. Agree with your adversary quickly while you're on the way with him, lest your adversary deliver you to the judge. Judge hand you over to the officer and you be thrown into prison. Surely I say to you, by no means get out of there until you pay the last penny. I don't know about you. That's a scary little verse there. And what he's telling us is this, and I think forgiveness for me, again, comes down to this, and I put this in my notes too. It's an act of worship. You realize that when you and I forgive someone, we are worshiping God. We're saying, God, you're number one. God, you've given me so much. God, you've taken care of me. You've provided for me. You sustained me. You've done all this for me. God, I give them to you. God, I give them to you. It's an act of worship. I remember Adrian Rogers was saying one time, I heard him, we were talking at a group, and he said one time, he was the president of the Southern Baptist Convention during a time when it got turned around from the liberal bunch that it was to more of a conservative bunch. And Dr. Rogers, I remember he said he was the president of the convention there. And as he was, he said he would get all these hate mail, he'd get all these letters in. People saying he was this and he was that, and he'd get all this kind of stuff in. And he just said it was just really disturbing him a lot because he said it was just hard to see people think this of you and say this about you and all these things. And just, he said, but then one day he said, I just sort of sat back at my desk and had all this mail on my desk. And he said, I looked at it and first thing you do when you get things like that is you check your heart to go, is it me? Because sometimes things can be true when people tell you, you know. Maybe you've messed up. Maybe you've done some things. But he said he checked his heart, and he looked at some things, and he said, finally he just stopped, and he pulled back, and he said, he said, I literally took these envelopes and letters, and I said, I lifted them up to the Lord. And he said, Lord, he said, I checked my heart. You checked my heart. I think I'm right. But Lord, and he just gave this, and he just pulled it up. He said, I wouldn't be going through this if it wasn't for you and my obedience to your word and my stand for you and my love for you and my worship for you. And I'll never forget, he looked and he said, and there's sort of tears in his eyes, he looked and he said, I lifted him up to the Lord and said, Lord, I give this to you as an act of worship. And he said, what happened was a peace came over my heart. I wasn't angry toward those people. I prayed for those people. I wasn't bitter toward those people. I prayed for those people. And it's just an act of worship. Can I tell you, forgiveness for you and for me will always be an act of worship. It's an act of worship when I was forgiven so much. Amen? It's an act of worship when I forgive so little sometimes to those who we harbor that. 3 John chapter 1, verse 4, John said this, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. If John can say that, I pray that prayer for my kids. But if John can say that, don't you know the Heavenly Father has no greater joy in us than when we walk in truth? Years ago, I'm closing with this. Years ago, Chelsea was younger. She was about 4, maybe. And I'll never forget, I was sitting on the couch on Saturday. I'm sitting on the couch and watching TV, you know. And she's over here in the corner. She's playing with this little truck. I think it was one of Ronnie's truck, because I mean, she may have been 5, but she was playing this little truck. And those trucks in those days had that axle like that and had the wheels that popped off. You know what I'm saying? So you had that. He had like this, and he had the axle that popped in. It'd lock in, and it'd pop out a little bit, you know, just pop in, pop out. Well, she was playing this little truck, and the wheel had popped out on one side, you know. And so she's over, and she's getting frustrated because she's trying to push it back in, but she's bending that little plastic piece, and it won't go back in a lock. And so as she's getting frustrated, and I look over, and I said to her, I said, Chelsea? She looks at me. I said, you want me to fix that for you? And she said, like that. And I said, okay. Watch for another couple minutes, and she's over there. I'm watching TV, and corner of my eye, I'm watching a little bit, and she's pushing, she's trying, she's going. And it's getting worse because it's bending even farther down. And I looked at her and I said, Chelsea, I said, bring that to Daddy, and I'll fix that for you. And she said, no, Daddy, I fix it. I said, okay. And that's getting a little funny as a dad. You know, I'm sort of watching it going, she's not going to get this fixed. And I'm watching. About a couple minutes later, I see this truck go flying across in front of me all the way to the wall. It hits the wall. It just goes boom, 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 like that. I see her over the corner. She's like this. She's upset. She's mad. So I'm sitting on this couch, and now I'm trying not to laugh. But I'm trying to be the dad, you know what I'm saying? I'm trying to be teachable moment. And so I looked at her and I went, Chelsea. I said, do you want me to fix that? And she looked at me, she goes. I said, you go get it, pick it up and bring it here to me, and I will fix it for you. She did, she went over, picked it up. Gave it to me. Well, again, I looked at it and I went, here's the problem. Look, it bent down, and I opened it and I popped it back in, spun the wheel around. I said, there you go, buddy. She goes, thank you, Daddy. Took off. I'll never forget. Again, we all go through different things sometimes. I was going through some different things. And so I remember just the Holy Spirit of God just sort of speaking to me and saying this. And again, he does this. He said, again, not audible voice, it's just in my heart. It just said, that's you. And I'm thinking, that's not me. She's a kid. Nah. And I'm thinking, and then God just sort of said, that's you. I've tried to fix this for you all the time, and you won't give it to me. If you'll give it to me, I'll fix it. Never forget. Went back, prayed, just gave it to God. I'm telling you, 2 weeks, what I was worried, concerned, over. Just because Ron, you may fix that? No. You mean take care of that?
Mm-mm.
I'll fix it. I'll take care of that. Mm-mm. I'll fix this. And then we get frustrated. Our lives start turning into all kinds of mess. And we go, and when God says, do you want me to fix that for you? And we say, finally. And God says, go get it. Let me have it. And I'll fix it for you. See, I think this issue of forgiveness is something that is so powerful and so devastating at the same time. That if you're harboring that in your life over anything, it could be somebody that's hurt you recently. It could be somebody that's hurt you in the past. They may be even gone. They may be even dead. You still got to deal with that. And you still got to forgive. And it's not about your feelings. It's not about your emotions. It's not about getting even or not getting. It's about just, thank God, thank you for giving me so much forgiveness. Thank you for doing so much with me. You've done so much I don't deserve. And God, I'm going to turn, be like you, and forgive, and set them free, cancel their debt, so that I can be right with you. I don't know where you're at, but no matter what you're dealing with today, if you're dealing with forgiveness of any kind, settle the issue. As I would tell the kids, dude, settle the issue. Don't walk around like that anymore. Get set free. God's done so much so you and I can do that in Jesus. Would you bow with me? The invitation is simple. If you're here this morning, you've never received Christ as your Savior, you might want to call on Him and say, Lord, forgive me of my sins. Forgive me of my sins. I turn from my sins and I turn to you. I believe. I put my trust in you. Forgive me, Lord. I trust you and you alone to save me. Call upon His name. He'll save you. You're here today. You say, you know what? I'm a Christian, but man, Ron, I tell you what. I've been dealing with this bitterness junk for years. Can I just encourage you in a moment? I'm going to give you a little time. A moment to, you can come to the altar right where you stand. Deal with it there. But I just would beg you today, don't leave here not forgiving. Make a choice. And that way the enemy comes back and says, you know what? You remember what they did? You say, I'm not thinking about that. I'm not going there because I forgave them last Sunday. Sunday morning, right in my seat. Sunday morning at that altar. Sunday morning, right there, I made a commitment to forgive. And I choose to forgive from my heart for all that God has done for me. I choose to forgive them. I was set free that day. They were set free that day. Enemy, go away. The word is spoken. God's word is true. And stand on His word. God will forgive. He'll change your life.